It is my deepest belief that just as I have a share in the God of Israel through my faith in him, that I stand under his authority and am included in the promise of redemption, so my Christian brother has his equal share in the God of Israel, stands equally under the authority and is included equally in the promise of redemption. For he is a son of Israel, equally with me. His faith has made him a son of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. My rights are his, and I have a share in his religious values, as he has a share in mine. Basing themselves on this concept of equality, the sons of every faith must justify themselves in works. Man's letter to God is a letter of works. God must be the ultimate expression of our relationship to each other on earth. It is my deepest belief that man has been chosen by God's grace from among all creatures. Apart from the intelligence which nature has given to every creature, which is included in nature and limited to the objective and conditioned, man alone among creatures possesses a soul which is a part of the endowment from above. Through his soul, man stands in mystic contact with heaven. By means of his soul, man can acquire intellectual and initiative powers which are outside the competence of nature. Derived from the highest inspiration of the divinity and are not limited to the objective and conditioned. God guides every individual destiny through the inspiration of the soul. This soul inspiration is given to each one and not only to the elect, so that everyone may, in the exercise of his free will, reach to the higher reason, which is the supreme level of the Holy Spirit. Accepting this point of view, it is further my profoundest conviction that the democratic principle in the social system, not less than in faith, is God's special gift to man and resides in the act of grace which God performed for man in choosing him among all creatures. The democratic principle is interwoven with faith and cannot be separated from God. In having been chosen by God, we became the children of God. For sons are ye of the Lord God, all of us, and not just a few individuals. Any other relationship, as between us and God, or as between ourselves, would contradict the will of the divinity and would be incompatible with all that has been given to the Jews by Moses and the prophets and all that has been given to the Christians by Jesus and the apostles. The democratic principle is all the law fulfilled in one word, even in these, to shall love thy neighbor as thyself. Galatians 5:14. This is the foundation which, together with the love taught God, was given through Moses, the prophets, the sages, Jesus of Nazareth, and the apostles. Thy neighbor as thyself does not mean that you must be mild in your dominion over him. It means that you shall not have dominion over him. He is a son of liberty, not less than you. In the relationship between you and him, can be built only in a system which assumes the identity of your rights. This is the democratic principle. And as the democratic principle is the will of God in the relationship between man and man, it is equally his will in the relationship between man and God. It is not in the heavens. The divine law was not given to the angels, but to us who are of the earth. It lies before us like an open book. The measure is in our hand. It has not been confined to the spiritual autocrats who arrogate to themselves the right to interpret God for all others, and to attribute their falseness to him so that he may be a participant in their sins. Not faith speaks, but works, and according to them we judge. Hence, I believe profoundly that there is no love of God without love of man. Service to mankind, it is, in my view, the higher service of the divinity. But service to mankind must not be seen in the throwing of crumbs to the poor. As we are eagle in our faith in God, so we must be eagle in our faith in men. We must work out a world order which shall rest upon equal distribution of labor and rewards. The right to have this must not remain an empty gesture in our Declaration of Independence. It must be incorporated in the administrative duties of the state. It must be interpreted in the material sense to which men are bound to their nature. In food, in clothing, in shelter, in the care of the aged, in our regard for widows, for the sick and the weak. All these must become a cardinal obligation for the state in its administration. The inner security of our citizen must become the cornerstone of our independence and freedom. It must become an obligation like the external security, not because we regard social injustice as the most potent instrument of the devil. Now it is indeed exactly that, but because without that obligation, our profession of faith are as empty as Dizer's oaths. This further my profoundest belief that we must lead a life in faith. That is, we must become that which we undertook to be a holy people. We can be a holy people only in a pure ethical life, a life ruled by laws and commandments. But no law and commandments, though they have a thousand eyes, and though they seem to control all our acts, can purify and sanctify us if the heart of man does not sanctify his life. The heart of man is a filter for all his acts and thoughts. If the heart is sound, man knows that his eyes' joy is bound up not with the dissoluteness and the free play of uncontrollable passion, but with purity, with modesty, and with restraint. There is no level of corruption from which man cannot redeem himself by the exercise of his free will. Whenever he makes an effort at such a redemption, he can be certain of help from above. For God's act of creation was not single and unique. It is a continuity of relationship through the individual destiny. I believe, therefore, that for every individual there is salvation, no matter how low he has sunk. Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, said the Lord God, and not that he should return from his ways and life? Ezekiel 18:23. The heart of man is bound with the divinity through the relationship of divinity. To the darkest and most horrible retreats to which men have withdrawn from the divinity, a ray of the divinity penetrates. And for this reason, we must never despair of a man, much less of a group which is temporarily lost to the divinity. Whoever deep a group has sunk, we must continue to pray for it and to help it with our desires and sympathies. And no matter how deeply we feel that we have been wronged by such a group, we must exhort ourselves to purify our hearts from bitterness. We were worms in our physical creation. We have become human in our hunger for the divinity. The drink of God, which was lifted to our lips by the authority, has enabled us to mount the ladder of Jacob, which rises from earth to heaven. If we will endure and continue the upward path, we will attain to the true salvation of a world which stands under the authority of God through a single universal Redeemer. The renewal of faith in the divine force of our moral values as our sole hope in the darkness of our night is what I would wish to submit to a suffering humanity. It is America which has been safe from the worst terrors of the night, which has not been corrupted with the cynicism which has been the undoing of Europe. It is America, young and powerful, blossoming in the virginity of faith, which must become the leading spirit among the nations. It is America, the land which has taken me in among the many other homeless ones as a child of her own, which I would like to see as a light to the gentles, leading the world back out of the night into the authority of the one and only God.